I've built a new rack with almost 40 CPU cores, over 2 terabytes of flash storage, almost 100 gigabytes of RAM, 2.5 gigabit networking backbone with a 10 gigabit uplink, an open source firewall that supports multiple gigs of upload and download speeds, ARM chips, Intel chips, and even an NVIDIA GPU to handle AI workloads or other super critical workloads, a KVM that gives me both local and remote access to all of my machines, that is also capable of providing a boot disk image if I need to re-image a machine. And if that wasn't enough, there are fans to keep it cool, temperature monitoring, RGB to make it faster, remote connectivity from anywhere in the world, and even a second monitor because one monitor is not enough. There are so many capabilities packed into this new rack, you're probably wondering how I fit it into my server room. The good news is I only had to make room on my workbench because the new rack is only 16 inches high and 10 inches wide. This is the DietPi RackMate T1, and don't be fooled by the name. While it is marketed for Raspberry Pis and other SBCs, I've managed to pack a whole lot more into this rack. While this mini rack may look small, it's providing some pretty big capabilities that you might only find in a much larger HomeLab stack. So can this mini HomeLab rack keep up with the big boys? And maybe an even more important question, will this build beat RAIDOWL's mini rack build? Let's find out as we break this stack down piece by piece, one U at a time. We'll cover all of the hardware and the software, including some of my regrets, starting with the rack. This DietPi RackMate T1 that was sent to me for review is what brings this project all together. This mini rack measures 10 inches wide, 16 inches high, and about 8 inches deep. The build quality on this rack is one of the first things that I noticed. It's made of aluminum, it's super solid, and the acrylic side panels make for a nice window to see inside. These side panels can make it challenging to work on once it's fully loaded, but I definitely think it's worth the trade-off. And this is an 8U standard rack, meaning that it's the same 1U for larger server racks, which gives this mini rack some interesting possibilities. This rack really feels like it was engineered by a tinkerer. It has lots of options for accessories, for mounting gear, a vented top to let the warm air out, and even handles for moving it around. Now, I had so much fun building this mini rack that I had to remind myself a few times that I still needed to make a video about it, and well, also beat RAIDOWL. So for this mini rack, here's my mini review. The upsides are it's well built, solid construction, and endless possibilities. It can be used for much more than just pies, and it has a well thought out design. Some of the downsides are the screw hole distances can be challenging sometimes, cable management is definitely a challenge, and it can get expensive when adding more accessories. Keeping on the theme of mini, from the top is the core to all of my networking, and that's the Protectly VP1210. This mini vault that was sent to me for review is one of the smallest vaults, and it's able to run network firewall operating systems without any problems. This model has the Intel 5195, that's a quad-core Intel Celeron N-series that has a TDP of only 10 watts. The CPU is pretty efficient, but also supports virtualization and quick sync if a network firewall isn't what you plan on building. It has dual 2.5 gigabit Ethernet ports, which is nice to see on a device this small, and it's totally silent because it has no fans at all. Oh, and it has this nice screw-in connector so that it doesn't accidentally get unplugged. I decided to install OpenSense on this to manage the internal network and edge firewall, and all I have to do is plug in the WAN port and I'm good to go. I could have also configured it for a site-to-site VPN to automatically connect back to home, but I decided to go with a jump box solution that you'll see later on. Now you might see the antennas on the vault, and those are attached to the Wi-Fi module, which is great. However, FreeBSD doesn't have any drivers for it. Otherwise, there are drivers for OpenWRT, Windows, and even Linux. So my mini review for this mini Protectly network firewall, the upsides are it's small, fanless, and low energy use. It has dual 2.5 gigabit Ethernet ports, and it's not limited to a firewall only. Some of the downsides are the RAM isn't upgradable, the optional Wi-Fi module has limited use for PFSense and OpenSense due to FreeBSD drivers. Now you might be wondering why my firewall is propped up. I picked up a 5-volt USB fan and decided to attach it to the rack. While taking it apart, I realized that I had a 120mm Noctua fan in my parts box that I could use. I swapped out the fan and then attached the fan to the top of the case through the vent holes, and it ended up working pretty good. This will pull hot air out of the rack while also allowing me to put the firewall on top without blocking the vents. I guess I ended up paying for just the fan case since I didn't need the fan, but it's totally worth it for $5 or $6. If we follow the LAN port from the network firewall, you'll see that it's uplinked to the switch. There were so many switches that came so close to fitting in these shelves, but most of them were off by a quarter of an inch. I ended up going with this Real HD switch, which has 8 2.5 gigabit Ethernet ports and one SFP Plus port for a 10 gig uplink. This is such a nice little switch if you want to get more 2.5 gigabit ports without buying a new switch. Now the switch is unmanaged and I did consider a managed one, but this was such a good deal and the perfect size for this rack that I decided that I didn't need a managed switch since this is only a test rack. And once you add on management to the switch, the cost almost doubles. With all of this networking means I can connect a lot of devices. The first device for compute is the B-Link EQ13 that was sent to me for review. Now I specifically asked to check out this one because I sent my dad the N100 version of this a while back and it's been running great ever since. But the EQ13 is a great little machine. It has the Intel N200, which is almost identical to the N100, but it can boost a little bit faster, up to 3.7 GHz, and it has more execution units on the GPU. It has 4 cores, supports virtualization, has quick sync, and a TDP of only 25 watts. The EQ13 ships with 16 GB of RAM and a 500 GB SSD. And it has an additional NVMe slot, although only one is 4x and the other is 1x, so put the faster drive in the faster slot. It supports both Wi-Fi 5 and Wi-Fi 6 and has dual Ethernet ports, but they're only 1 gigabit per second. Now that's fine for my use case, but this might be something to consider if you're using it for a router. Another thing that I like about this is that the power supply is inside, which means I don't have to worry about a huge power adapter when plugging this in. It really helps keep the build clean. I decided to use the EQ13 as a dual boot Windows and Linux machine and it runs great. It boots in seconds and everything is so snappy when using it. I'm using this machine as a jump box to get inside of the network and I do this using Tailscale. I just turn on Tailscale, remote into the Windows or Linux machine and I'm in. Just like that. No port forwarding, no firewall rules, it's really that simple. So my mini review for the B-Link EQ13 mini PC, the upsides are, it's efficient but powerful, it has dual network ports, it has no problem running anything you want, from Windows to Linux to a hypervisor, all work great. Some of the downsides are, both ports are limited to 1 gigabit per second, it's limited to 16 gigabytes of RAM, and the SSD that ships with it doesn't seem to work in the second slot. Now after testing out the EQ13, I liked it so much that I ended up buying one from Amazon to be my hypervisor in this mini rack stack. Now you might think that you need something large and powerful to run virtualization, but if you just need a few VMs for testing, mini PCs with NVMe drives will do the trick. So that's what I did and I created a few VMs. Two are Ubuntu servers, one is a Docker machine and one is a Kubernetes node, and the other is a TrueNAS scale server. Wait. A TrueNAS server on that little machine as a VM? Yup. And it works pretty well. I created a TrueNAS server so that I can share files and backup VMs to this machine. It's nice to have an SMB share available to all of my lab machines and this does the trick. I attached both SSD drives to one of the DietPi trays, which had these nice little holes for SBCs and SATA drives, and then I connected them both to a USB adapter and then to the mini PC. I then attached those USB ports to the virtual machine that's running on Proxmox. This gave me a terabyte of mirrored flash storage for backups and shares. Now I know that USB connected drives aren't what you'd use in a production system, but this is HomeLab, right? Moving on. Below is the Touring Pi 2 that I did a video on a while back and I decided to give it a nice home in this rack. The Touring Pi 2 is a mini ITX board that lets you connect different modules like the Raspberry Pi Compute module, the Touring RK1, and a Jetson Nano from Nvidia. These modules can be mapped to components on the board, basically giving you 4 machines in one. I considered powering this board with an ATX power supply, but I had a Pico PSU from an old build and decided to power it that way. There wasn't a great place for the barrel jack to go, so I drilled a hole and mounted it to the tray and it turned out pretty good. Then, in the Touring Pi 2 board, I seated 3 Raspberry Pi CM4 nodes and 1 RK1 node from Jeff Geerling that he just sent to me. Thanks, Jeff. I built a small Kubernetes cluster using K3S. The server node is one of the Ubuntu VMs we talked about earlier, and the worker nodes are these CM4s. So as far as a mini review for the Touring Pi 2 mini ITX cluster board, the upsides are, it's great to have all of this compute in one place, you can mix and match different types of modules, and there are lots of connectivity options. The downsides are, dual gigabit ports might not be enough throughput depending on your workloads, and if you plan on going with RK1 modules to use NVMe, it's going to get pricey really quick. Below the Turing Pi 2 is a Jetson Nano and an older Raspberry Pi. Now we know what you're thinking, that I'm probably running some awesome AI or machine learning workloads to take advantage of that onboard NVIDIA GPU. Nope. I decided to turn it into a retro Pi station. This little Jetson has no problem running retro games, and when you pair it with a Retech X8 keyboard, you have a serious little retro gaming machine. This Retech keyboard is pretty nice, and it's compact and has a nice curve to it. Almost like a gamepad, except for it has a full keyboard, a touchpad for using the mouse, a directional pad, and even a scroll wheel. It also has a rechargeable lithium-ion battery that seems to never quit. This keyboard is great for the occasional username and password, but anything other than that would get annoying really quick. It's the definition of jack-of-all-trades and master-of-none, because it does everything pretty well, but nothing great. That aside, I'm glad I found it, and it's perfect for this mini rack. Oh yeah, and I picked it because it has RGB. Duh. So my mini review for this mini Retech keyboard, the upsides are, it's cheap, the touchpad is actually good, it's a compact way to get a keyboard, mouse, and a quote-unquote gamepad. The downsides are, it's mediocre as a keyboard, it's mediocre as a gamepad, and it's mediocre as a mouse. Oh, that Pi that I mentioned that's right next to it? That's just there because it's better than being there than in the drawer. It's nice to have a spare Pi to run things like DietPi or PiOS, to use as a jump box or wake the other machines up using Wake on LAN. Now you might be wondering how I have all of these monitors connected to all of these machines. Well, I have four machines connected to this EasyKoo KVM switch that I bought a while back, and it's a super solid and compact KVM. Now by itself, it's a great little KVM, but what makes it really nice is that it pairs well with the Pi KVM. The Pi KVM is a little box that gives you KVM over IP, or simply put, an easy way to remote control any machine connected to the network or anywhere in the world when you install Tailscale on it. Now typically you can only control one machine with the Pi KVM, but the EasyKoo KVM has a communication port on it that the Pi KVM can use to change the input. This is all accessible from a web interface, and there's no software to install because it connects to the video out of each machine and the USB for keyboard and mouse. Another cool thing that you could do is add a USB hub and attach USB devices like my Ventoy USB drive that lets me boot and install any operating system I want. The developer of Pi KVM sent me a V4 to replace my older Pi KVM V3. What's really cool about the V4 Plus is that it now supports video pass-through. This means you can use the KVM locally, just like you would a normal KVM. However, since it's also an IP KVM, you can use it remotely too. Now, I've been testing this feature for a few weeks, and I have to say it's fantastic for the times you just want to use a keyboard and mouse without remoting into the web GUI. Now, this device is not cheap, so if you're thinking about getting a V4 Plus, you'll definitely want to pair it with a KVM like the EasyKoo, so you can use it for multiple machines and spread out the cost. But if you only need one device, the Pi KVM Mini is also an option. So my mini review on the Pi KVM V4 Plus, the upsides are, it's remote access made easy, open source means updates for life, the HDMI pass-through feature is great. The downsides are, it will be expensive for some, some devices are picky, like my 11th gen Intel NUC, and no real solution for servers with VGA, because those adapters rarely work. Also, since I mentioned the EasyKoo, I may as well give my mini review on the Mini KVM 2. The upsides are, it's small, metal, and compact. You can change inputs with a button, infrared, or even hotkey. Some of the downsides are, the price has gone up considerably since the Pi KVM became popular, and cable management can be a nightmare. If we work our way back up to the top, you see these two 7-inch monitors. I picked these up at different times from different retailers. They're great for displaying the output of these machines when you're working on them, or even to kick back and play a retro game or two. The left monitor is connected to the Pi KVM setup, and the right monitor is plugged into the second HDMI on one of the EQ13s. This lets me use the left monitor for the currently selected input on the KVM, and the right monitor is really just used for dashboards. Now, I could have gone all out and created my own dashboards, but each system that I use has a pretty decent one. I found this Chrome extension that will cycle through tabs on a timer, and that worked out better than I thought it would, giving me all of the information I want to see on this screen. Now, these monitors both have HDMI, composite, and VGA connections, which is great for older machines or servers, and can be powered by a 12-volt barrel jack. That's where the similarities end and some of the quirks come in. My mini review for the left mini monitor. The upsides are, it's sleek and the buttons are in back. It powers off when there's no source. Some of the downsides are, it has an annoying label printed on it that I colored over with a Sharpie, and the color is not as good as the one on the right. And my mini review for the right mini monitor. The upsides are, the color is much better than the left. It's much sharper than the left. Some of the downsides are, it's less sleek and has buttons on the front. It doesn't power off when there isn't a source and the screen turns blue. Even though these are both very different, I've come to like each in their own respect. These monitors are attached to the rack with these magic arms that are great for camera gear, and it turns out that both of these monitors have the quarter-inch screw hole that fits the magic arm perfectly. This lets me adjust the position of the monitors and even the rotation if I want to go full hipster. The tension arms are a little tricky to use for the first time, but once you get the hang of it, you can really lock them into place. One thing you might have noticed is this little pink thing in the rack. This is the beta version of the X Effect by Craft Computing. This little device tracks temperature, humidity, and more coming soon. I have it hooked up to Home Assistant to visualize the data, and I've been testing new firmware as it's been released. If you've seen this device on his channel, you might be wondering why it's pink. Well, that's because I asked for the hottest pink ever. I have to agree, it's the hottest pink I've ever seen. It's a fun little device that I've been testing, and I'm looking forward to the final release. Check out Craft Computing if you're interested in picking one up. Because this is a beta product for me to test the hardware and software, I don't think it's fair to give a mini review, but here's my mini feedback so far. Some of the things I like are, it's super accurate, fast readings, and it's very stable and very dependable. It's pretty much set it and forget it. Some of the things I'd like to see improved or added in the final product, remote flashing of the device, more mounting options, and a Prometheus endpoint would be awesome. After installing and configuring everything in this rack, I have to say it's pretty awesome. Having these machines isolated in this mini rack physically and even virtually make this a pretty powerful little home lab. I also love that I can take one network cord, plug it in anywhere, and still have remote access to it. And although I love this little lab and it's great, there were still many challenges I faced along the way. Like cable management. I thought for sure I was going to keep my cables managed, but after adding a KVM and 5 machines, it can get out of control really quick. My advice would be to buy cables that are the right size, like these 12-inch HDMI cables. Oh, and for you metric folks out there, that's like 2 bubbly waters stacked on top of each other. Then there's all of these 5-volt and 12-volt adapters. I considered buying some of those USB-C to DC adapters out there so I could live the USB-C life. But after reading a lot of the reviews of some of these cables, I was scared I might fry some of the components. In the end, I just decided to put all of my power cables in this box and call it a day. Oh, and I almost forgot one more thing in back here. Building this mini rack was super fun, but don't be fooled by its size. Not only will you spend about the same amount of time building it as you would a larger rack, you might end up spending just as much money too. But that aside, there's something to be said about a full home lab with dual monitors and 2.5 gigabit networking that only uses around 80 watts of power and can fit on top of your desk. I'm Tim. Thanks for watching.